Yes, welcome along to episode 4 of Upping The Ante in association with Bet365 with David Jennings and Gavin Lynch, counting down to the 2021 Cheltenham Festival. Gavin, my training for the charity cycle started in earnest last
Excellent.
Night.
Good.
I went for an 8-kilometre run.
Good man.
And after about 6K, I have to say I was delighted to get the phone call. My dad rang me. So I stopped at the graveyard in Dunchoclan, a topical place to stop because I felt like dying, and my father rang me, so I was chatting away anyway, and this fella on the other side of the road was flying, and I was demoralised watching him running,
sprinting.
Here he was coming sprinting, doing a run. Do you know who it was? Keith Donoghue, the jockey. Yeah,
he's a very sick boy. Keith's actually coming to do the cycle with us, and so is Barry Geraghty and Paul Carby and a few other people. So
who's who of racing doing the charity cycle?
I'll tell you more next week.
Okay, more to follow. How was your week?
Yeah, grand. I got the few quid back this week that I lost last week.
So good to hear.
But Saturday and Sunday, I would never ever get a chance to sit down for 3 hours on a Saturday or Sunday, family life and so on, to watch racing. But thankfully this weekend I did, and it was amazing.
And you are the founding member of the Envoi Allen fan club. Well, did you get jiggy?
I was mad excited after the race. Yeah, I was on a high, I'd say, for an hour after. I love him. Absolutely adore him. Now, obviously, he has a lot to prove to get up to the Cato Stars of this world and the Desert Orchids and the Istabraks and so on, but just what not to love. And the thing about him is that he gives you no excuses. It doesn't matter about ground, it doesn't matter about trip, it doesn't matter about tactics, making the run and sitting in behind. Just, he's a Rolls Royce.
You love him.
Love him.
And there will be more about Envoi Allen later in the show. Let's get cracking. So you know the drill by now. We kick off with our questions from the crowd. And the first question this week comes in from Owen O'Regan. And Owen wants to know the best horse, Gavin, never to have won at the Cheltenham Festival.
Firstly, brilliant question.
Brilliant question. I'm putting that to the top of the list so far. The best question we've got so far.
So one of them, I'm going to give you a chaser and a hurdler. One of them came to me fairly quick and the other one I kind of had to do bit of looking up.
But
the one that came to me quick enough was Carvel's Hill. Mm. Maybe you're too young.
Little bit.
Yeah. He was another fantastic racehorse. He went off 5-1 to win a Gold Cup when he was a novice. A few years later, he was even money to win. But then the Golden Free scenario, I don't know if you've ever seen it. That was hard television to watch.
So Jerry Pippen put the horse upside, jumped alongside.
Golden Free's, I think Ted Walsh trained him before that. But he was a brilliant jumper, and then jockey would pull him back to sit beside Carvel's Hill. Carvel's Hill had a dodgy back, but he ended up being rated 182. But if his jumping had been better, he would have been even higher rated. So I think he was in the top 20 chasers of all time, but he didn't win a Cheltenham.
Okay, Carvel's Hill, your top chaser, your top hurdler?
Top hurdler is definitely Limestone Lad.
Yeah, the great Limestone
Lad. He was second and third in the Stayers hurdle. I think he had an official rating at the time of 177, which puts him in the top 10 hurdlers of all time. Even though he didn't win at Cheltenham. He was only £3 behind Istabrak, who he beat once.
Yeah, beat Istabrak in the Hatton's Grass Hurdle.
I think he was only £5 behind, was it Sea Pigeon? Sorry, Night Nurse was the highest at 182. So.
And he ran in that famous Stairs Hurdle with Barracuda, Iris's Gift.
Mm-hmm. So he was a great horse. And you?
Okay, mine is a horse that never got to fulfil his potential. It's a horse called Nick Dundee, who I remember, I was mid to late 90s when I was kind of 10 to 15. I really got into it. And I just thought Nick Dundee, I was devastated when he fell in the RSA, which was the Sun Alliance Chase probably the back then. Yeah. That looks like trouble won. And he was tanking under Norm Williamson. And he fell
at the Irish banker, wasn't he?
He was 5-4 favourite. He fell under Norm Williamson. And he was never really the same horse again after that. But I remember when he won the Dr. PJ Moriarty Novice Chase before that at Leopardstown. I was there. And it was breathtaking. He was just a brilliant horse who, just after that fall in the Sun Alliance, just never got to fulfil his potential. But I always thought if everything went right, he would have been best mate.
And that's back in the time when if Ireland had, say, 3 winners at Cheltenham, it was a good Cheltenham. So it shows you how things have changed.
Absolutely. Great question, Owen. Our next question this week comes in from Jack Flaherty. And Jack wants to know about Master Tommy Tucker, one of my many guilty pleasures. He wants to know, after Master Tommy Tucker's brilliant performance at Haydock, should he go for the Gold Cup, Gavin?
He might as well. He's 9 turning 10, so he's 10 next month. He might get a better chance. But
I could be wrong here, right? But he's just not your type of horse.
Not particularly. Look, he hasn't done it at Grade 1 level. He did fall in the Cato Star Novices Chase at
would've
the front last.
Would have won it.
Yeah, it's a long way out. Maybe he would have.
Stop, he would have.
He's better going left-handed, so that'll suit him for Cheltenham. He was impressive the last day. He's actually a good jumper, even though I think he's ran 9 times and fallen 3 times. But he's got an official rating of 157. An album photo, I think, is up at 175. So he's £18 behind. Mm. So he's a lot to make up. I think he's 33s and 50s.
The only thing I will say about Master Tommy Tucker, because I followed this horse from the very start. I just love him, right? And yeah, he can fall. He, he's a brilliant jumper, but when he makes a mistake, he just falls. There's no in between, you know. But this year he's been sorting his feet out a little bit better. But anyway, I think we are fooled into thinking, because he's real keen, that he's quite a quick horse. I think he's actually a slow horse. I think he's crying out for a stamina test. Okay. I just think he's a galloper. And I just think, as he gets older, now that he's learning to settle, now that he's starting to enjoy it, I think he's got loads of ability, this horse.
Would you back him in the ultimate top weight of 157, would you?
He has the potential to absolutely bolt up in an ultimate. Obviously, that's a big claim. But if he did get into a rhythm, he could absolutely outclass a handicap field off that mark. Okay. But there's just so many question marks attached to him, isn't there? We don't know how good he is. He could fall. He could be too keen. So there's a lot of ifs and buts.
But he's a good horse.
Yeah. I love horses with ifs and buts. I love them because you never know how good they are. So there you go. That is Master Tommy Tucker. And our final question this week comes in from Terence Longdon, who wants to know, is Henry de Bromhead bonkers to be thinking about the champion hurdle for Honeysuckle, who is in every single Gavin Lynch multiple for the mare's hurdle? Gavin, this is worrying.
She's a few in a few.
This is worrying.
Well, I'll tell you what, a year ago, I was thinking maybe she would go for the champion hurdle because it looked a very weak division. And then, of course, along came Epitant, who is a proper champion. I'd imagine she'll go for the mares, but what'll happen is she's going to run the Irish Champion Hurdle next at the end of January, and I suppose maybe she'd want to win that to go to the champion, but if she gets beat, I think she'll go to the mares.
Would you be hoping she might be getting beat? I don't know. You would? Maybe. Do you think she'd have any chance in the Champion Hurdle?
I wouldn't think so. I think her jumping is good. She looks like a big kind of a chaser maybe, but even if you watched the side-on view the other day when she came to the second last, she's a length in front, and by the time she lands, she's nearly upsides. Beacon's Edge. So I think her jumping could be caught out a little bit.
Okay, so I was on duty for the Racing Post at Ferry House on Sunday, and I interviewed Henry de Bromhead after the race, and obviously I'm guessing, I don't know, but I just thought all his answers were kind of along the lines of, well, we kind of have the Mayor's Hurdle banked and the Champion Hurdle, we'll see how the Irish Champion Hurdle goes. But I just, from reading Henry, he's given this serious consideration.
So Georgia could go for the Champion Hurdle.
Honeysuckle could go for the Champion Hurdle. I would say it's very much 50-50. Before Sunday, I would have said it was 80-20 Mayor's Hurdle, Champion Hurdle. But I think it's 50-50.
She's a great mare anyway.
Sorry about that, Gavin.
Okay.
Not good news for your multiples. That was this week's Questions from the Crowd. So now, folks, it's time for the week that was. Yes, where Gavin Lynch tells you what he thinks about all the good horses that ran over the last 7 days. And Gavin, there was quite a few.
There was a lot. Brilliant week's race. I'm going to start on Tuesday in Punchestown. Col Reavy, gorgeous big mare. She was fifth in the Mare's Novice Hurdle last year, but she's just a chaser. She won by 15 lengths. What I'm going to say to you now is probably going to annoy you, but I think Cheltenham should be over 5 days. I think there should be 6 races a day, which is 30. We've 28 at the minute. Bring back the Novice Handicap and bring in a Mare's Novice Chase. Because it's unfair for her to be taken on, say, Put the Kettle On or maybe Benny DeJew come March.
Okay.
We already have a Mare's Hurdle and a Mare's Novice Hurdle. Mare's Chase, Mare's Novice Chase. I think she'd have a massive
First question,
yes.
Why would you think I'd be annoyed at that? I wrote a column saying
that
I'd have no problem if it went 5 days. I can also see the other side. And there will be people watching this, including our own Irish editor, Richard Forrestal, that will be tearing whatever hair he has left out. Okay?
Because you have 5 days in Goodwood, you have 5 days in Ascot, you have 5 days in
But you're diluting the quality, Gavin. That's the argument.
It's 6 races a day. But it also gives you room then if you want to add in a veteran's chase or a whatever.
Okay.
Anyway, that's just...
A five-day Cheltenham Festival. That means we'd have to start up in the Ante maybe in August.
It'd be another day off work. Thursday in Thurles, a horse called Galois was very impressive. Showed a lovely turn of foot. 12-1 for the Mayor's Novice Hurdle for Willie Mullins. She won by 5.5 lengths. She had won. She'd won on the flat in France, but she looks a good mare. Newbury on Friday, some great racing. Just to mention, Flinter Sacra got beat at 2-5. He was a major talking horse for Nicky and Nico, and he got well stuffed, was way, way too keen, went off 2-5 and got beat, so he's out to 20s for the Supreme.
Your brother's a very nice fella, isn't he? Just goes to show you.
Yeah.
Family members, they're not all the same.
Sprinter Sacra. Brave Man's Game, it was very impressive in winning by 7.5 lengths.
I love him, Gam.
It had been beaten 3 times, then won in Exeter, bolted up the other day. He looks a real chaser in the making. He gives his hurdles plenty of air. He's 20s for the Ballymore and 16s for the Bartlett. You like him?
Oh, I like him.
Caribbean Boy, I thought was very impressive.
Yes.
Beat Fiddler on the Roof by 4 lengths. Now, it's not a novice. That was a novice chase, but it's just lost its novice status now.
Terrific time.
Yeah, correct. He's got a rating before that of 144. I would love to see him going for the Burn Plate, but I'd say he'll probably end up in a Ryanair.
Did you watch the race on ITV?
I know it was on Racing TV.
Okay. Well, they do this thing now on ITV. In that race, Ruby Walsh, Mick Fitzgerald and Luke Harvey talk through the races, okay, though they're riding one of the horses. And I actually thought it was going to be a terrible idea. Okay. And I thought it was going to be shocking. And I actually really enjoyed it.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
As you say, it was 6 seconds quicker than the handicap chase. So Caribbean Boy is a very good horse. Then we're on to the long distance hurdle. Thyme Hill, Paisley Park and McFabulous. Mm. McFabulous just didn't stay.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
Yeah, maybe, yeah. I thought there was maybe an overreaction to his run. As in, like, he finished third, he was banged there, he had every chance. But he was the one taking the biggest step up in class.
Yeah, I just wouldn't back him over 3 miles again.
No,
I don't think he'll run over 3 miles again. I'd love to see him in the Coral Cup off 1.53. Paisley Park ran a very, very nice race. Obviously, there's a heart issue there going back to last March. So maybe they didn't have him totally, totally fit. He was given a little bit of weight away to Thyme Hill, who was very, very impressive. It was gas at the start of the race. Nobody wanted to lead at the start. It took forever to get going, but Thyme Hill was very good.
Like me in that cycle, I think, Gavin.
But it shows the Albert Bartlett form is probably decent.
And the big question is, he was getting weight, obviously, Thyme Hill was getting weight from Paisley Park. He won't be getting the weight from Paisley Park at Cheltenham in the Stairs Hurdle. If you were to back either Thyme Hill or Paisley Park in the Stairs Hurdle, who would you back?
I'd go with Thyme Hill. He's 9-2. I think Paisley Park is 5-1. And the reason is that Thyme Hill is 6, turning 7, whereas Paisley Park is 8, turning 9. So I would just usually go for the younger horse.
And as you well know, we have both selected Sire de Burleigh for Stairs Hurdle at 10-1, Bet365. How worried are you about Thyme Hill after seeing the race?
Look, as somebody who said they can't run on their own, you'll always have dangers. I would be a bit worried, but I think it's a very open race, the Stairs. But the two of them set a good standard.
Excellent.
Newcastle, then we're on to Saturday, Epitant. A bit of a messy race, the first two hurdles, we lost two horses, etc. Beats O'Royal by 4.25 lengths. It's just the gears that she has. Oh, yeah. She really is another Rolls Royce.
And she drifted out to, I think, 2.3 on Betfair on Friday. It was a remarkable drift, and obviously then the support
huge
came.
Drift, even money there on Saturday morning, and I'm saying to myself, whether to have a big bet in it or not.
Did you?
I kind of did half a big bet, but she's a fantastic horse. I love the way she jumps. She's nice and quick. She's a bit like Bouverdaire. She's low and fast. I thought the commentator got a bit carried away after the line, but maybe I'm wrong. Mm. She's 6-4 for the champion hurdle. As we said last week, it'll take an amazing gelding to give her £7. Mm. Bet365 are ducking her a little bit at 6-4, but I think they're right. Mm. I wouldn't like to lay her in here.
Wouldn't disagree.
Newbury on Saturday, next destination. Had been off for 2.5 years and then ran in Wetherby in over 3 mile behind Roxana. First time over fences, jumped brilliantly. At the fourth and third last, I thought to myself, could be in a spot of bother.
He's hardy though, isn't he?
He's
tough.
He showed that when he was a novice hurdler. Mm-hmm. He was very, very tough. But he's 10-1 for the RSA and 12-1 for the National Unchase.
It was a good day for ex-Willie Mullins rejects, wasn't it? Next destination, York Hill.
York Hill. Lee Westwood. Cloth Cap won the Ladbrokes Trophy by 10 lengths off 1.36. Perhaps he'll end up in a handicap at Cheltenham. His jumping was incredible.
Electric.
We're on to Fairy House on Saturday. The first one to mention is Monkfish. Beat his stable companion on the ropes by 4 lengths. On the ropes 1.37. So it's not that an amazing performance. Same time as the handicap chase. The time was fine. It jumped brilliantly except for one slight mistake down the back straight. Obviously won the Bartlett last year. And you're saying to yourself, like, this time last year he looked a slow horse and now he doesn't.
There are people saying now that the Arkell, the Marsh and what was used to be known as the RSA, forget about them because we know who's going to win them. It's going to be Shishkin, it's going to be Envoi Allen and it's going to be Monkfish. Is it that cut and dried?
It's never that easy. Like last year in Cheltenham, I remember friends of mine were doing accumes and trebles and stuff in February. There was 5 hot pots in Cheltenham last year. Even money, 6-4, etc. Only one of the 5-1.
Yeah, Tiger Roll was beaten. And
there was lots of them beat. It's never that straightforward, but certainly Monkfish is the right favourite. He's 4-1 with Bet365 for the RSA. Concertista, I was very, very impressed with this.
So was I.
Very impressed. Mm. Paul Townend seemed to suit the horse. Just fantastic ride to come late. It was a bit like Jamie Spencer, as we mentioned last week. 9 seconds quicker than the handicap hurdle. The time was very fast. I've backed Honeysuckle. But since Saturday, I've had a saver on Concertista. I think she's a big danger.
It's spring mare too.
Yeah, exactly. And she won the Mayor's Novice last year by 12 lengths. Hookup was very impressive, winning a
big chance in the Mayor's Novice hurdle.
Yeah, her
big
jumping chance. Would want to improve a little bit, but sure it could. There's no reason why you can't. She's a fine big mare. She's 11-1 for the Mayor's Novice. And it was actually 8 seconds quicker than the other maiden hurdle, which was won by Kescon Risk, who's a very expensive purchase. JJ Slevin, he got away with it. It was a bad ride. He left it too late. He just got there. The horse dug him out of a hole.
Watches the show.
But 33-1 for the Supreme. I'd say that could be a very good horse, even though the time wasn't that fast.
So bad ride, but good horse.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sunday in Fairy House, just an amazing day's racing.
You enjoyed it, didn't you?
Just, I swear to God, never enjoyed a day as much. Zana here.
As you were told on this show last week, Zana here is the real deal.
He is, yeah. He's now 7-1 for the Triumph. And the thing that I loved was the time of the race. 4.02, the handicap hurdle was 4.08, the bumper was 4.06, the Royal Bond was 4.12. He's a fine, big horse. He jumps great. So he's a very good horse. Bally Adam, as we mentioned, slow time in the Royal Bond, but it's very hard to go from a maiden hurdle in Down Royal to a grade one. Now, he only beat horses rated 1.38 and 1.37 in Cask Mate and Angola. So he probably ran to 1.45. Generally, to win a Supreme, you need to run, say, 1.52.
Ted Walsh and RT said that any bookmakers offering 13-2 about Bally Adam should be locked up in jail because they're robbers. He gives the horse no chance.
Look, at his jumping would want to improve. He made two bad mistakes.
Fine.
Yeah, well, he did make two mistakes, but
one. Where was the second one?
There was one on the middle hurdle up the back, or the first hurdle up the back, and the last hurdle. I thought he was
at the last.
Yeah, he banged it out of the way.
Yeah, but I just thought Jack knew the races in the bag.
But he's got loads of gears. I'd imagine Jack will hold on to him a lot longer the next time because he has one dart of speed.
Nice horse.
Like if you watch Sam Bennett in the Tour de France, he comes the last 100 yards.
He does, yeah.
He's no abracadabras. Next we have the man himself, Envoi Allen.
It's himself, is it?
Himself, yeah. I just thought he was amazing. His jumping is brilliant. As they said on the TV, he seems an intelligent horse. He's got the ears pricked. Jack just lets him do whatever he wants and he pops away or he meets it long. And then, obviously, the camera angles were brilliant at Fairy House at the weekend.
They were. And a bit like the three lads doing the commentary on ITV on the race on Friday, I thought I'd hate it, and I didn't like it last year, but I actually really enjoyed it on Sunday.
Just wouldn't like to be the fella sitting on top of the drone up in the sky. He must be freezing. But great camera angles.
Nobody up there.
And at the side of the second last, you see him, you know, assemble joins him, and then just the change of gear.
Yeah, it was...
I was going to say to you, Dave, anybody who says that it had better 5 minutes 29 seconds over the weekend than that is probably lying to you.
Oh, well, you never know what people do in their private life, Gavin.
But, yeah, brilliant,
so
fit, brilliant.
So 7-4, bet 365 now, is that right for the Marsh?
6-4,
okay,
yeah.
Okay, 6-4. Were you surprised, even though it wasn't a great race, that he wasn't evens, just say?
Yeah, I was. I thought he'd be even money.
Okay. Have you him in singles?
Yeah.
Have you him in doubles?
Yeah.
Trebles? Lucky 15s?
No lucky 15s yet, no.
Okay.
But yeah, an amazing horse, and I just hope he keeps winning and winning and winning. The only horse I can think that remained unbeaten was Feathered Lady. A pal said it to me the other day. She ran seven or eight times.
Yeah, won at Kempton on...
Yeah, and then she retired, unfortunately. But just, it'd be amazing if he can stay unbeaten.
If Envoi Allen wins the Marsh Chase at the 2021 Cheltenham Festival, does that mean that you cannot lose for the week?
No, I probably could, yeah.
Okay.
I'd love to see somebody put up a huge prize fund for Envoi Allen and Shishkin to meet each other in Punchestown, because they'll never meet if they don't meet this year.
Yeah. The Upping the Ante Chase, we could call it.
Court Maid was very, very impressive in a handicap chase. She won by 13 lengths off 140. I would give her a chance in the National Hunt Chase.
Price?
She is 14s. I've had a saver on her because I've backed Galvin. But I think she's a bit of a danger.
You haven't savers in November.
Yeah. Honeysuckle, we've mentioned. Ronald Pope ran a cracker. He has to have a bit of a squeak again in the stairs hurdle. She's now 10 from 10, including the point to point. She's a brilliant mare. She thought she was going to maybe win easier than she did at the death. They didn't go a great gallop on that one.
Do we give Matthew Smith enough credit for Ronald Pump? Snapped up for £1,000, nothing to look at. This horse finished second in the stairs hurdle. He's won a beginner's chase. He's finishing second in the Hatton's Grace. He's a strong fancy for the stairs hurdle again this year. He's done a remarkable job.
The one thing
you
have to remember about him last year is that he won a beginner's chase at Fairy House.
Yes.
Then went to hurdles at Christmas.
Yes.
Then went to a chase, I think, at an ace.
Yes.
Then went to the stairs hurdle and finished second.
Yeah.
So that's not an ideal prep for a stairs hurdle. Whereas this year it's going to go here, Christmas, and then
crashed into the last in March as well. I could definitely see him being placed. Just a better race this year.
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
So that's the week that was.
Sorry, I interrupted you there. Is that it?
Yep.
That is the week that was. So every week here on Upping The Ante, we preview one of the big races at the 2021 Cheltenham Festival. And this week, it is the turn of the Stairs Hurdle. And at the moment, with Bet365, after his terrific performance at Newbury on Friday, Time Hill is the 9-2 favourite. The horse he conquered at Newbury on Friday, former winner Paisley Park, is 5-1. It's 7-1 Sire de Berlay, 8-1 Benny the Jew, and it's 12-1 Honeysuckle 14's Bar, which brings in Fury Road. Gavin, it's an interesting race that was made even more interesting by what we saw at Newbury on Friday. Time Hill, 9-2 favourite, deservedly so?
Yeah, I'd say so. It won very well. It was getting £3, but I don't think that was the difference. It was the best horse in the day. Travelled great, jumped well. Perfect performance.
Do you know what I loved about him? His jumping down the back. I just thought, on that side camera angle, I just thought he was landing running. He had loads of scope. He was kind of taking off and land. I just loved his jumping. Mm-hmm. Loved him.
Look, there's no quirks to him. He'll definitely come up the hill. He was a bit unlucky last year in the Bartlett, which was sore for people that backed it, including myself. But, you know, the Bartlett's working out very well with Monkfish. But if you give Time Hill a chance, you have to give Fury Road a chance.
The first four that were clearly the four best horses in the Albert Bartlett have all won first time out this year. So latest exhibition won his beginner's chase. Time Hill obviously won, Fury Road won, and Monkfish won. So it was a particularly good renewal of the race.
You'd have to say maybe Fury Road is a bit of value at 14s because it finished just ahead of Time Hill in the Bartlett. So, but it's a very, very open race.
You're in no doubt that Fury Road would probably uphold that form.
Probably. It just depends how fit Paisley Park was. We don't know.
I love the way I put no doubt and probably in the same sentence there. That doesn't actually make sense.
But Time Hill is the younger horse, but it depends if Paisley Park...
Right, let's not get lukewarm here. We both nailed our colours to the mast. We said Sire de Berlay. We both went from the same week. And he's a little bit different, maybe not to Paisley Park, but to Time Hill, Benny Dedu, Roxana, as in he's just tough and will relish a battle.
Yeah, and he's come the handicap route. But the winner of the pretemps twice... He just loves the new track. There's only two hurdles in the last mile because his jumping is only okay. It's not brilliant, but he absolutely loves a battle. Mm. If you watch him in the pretemps, he's kind of on and off it a bit. And then just before the last, here he is on the bridle again. Yeah. So, and to beat the storyteller and giving him weight was a great performance.
And even at Navan on his return over 2.5 miles, it was still a really good performance to actually win the race. And Ronald Pump has franked the form.
Yeah, Ronald Pump has to have a chance. Second last year, 20-1, ran a cracker on Sunday. So it's a very open race.
Yeah. We put race. Up Sire de Berlay 10-1. He's 7-1 now. Still value at 7?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Wow, okay.
Yeah. Wow. Be a good race at Christmas between him and Ronald Pump, I'd say.
And the likes of Roxana, would you give her any chance?
Yeah, she was mad impressive in Weatherby. The only thing is, the talk is that she might go to Aintree, but lovely mare. Again, getting the weight.
They might be tempted. We'll learn more, obviously, in the long walk at Ascot. I think it's the Friday before Christmas, so that'll be an interesting race for her Stairs Hurdle.
Yeah, no, it looks a really good renewal this year.
But it's Sire de Berlay for you.
Yep.
Sire de Berlay for me. And it could be Sire de Berlay for you. Okay, folks. Members Club Ultimate is the Racing Post premium service. I use it. More importantly, Gavin Lynch uses it. We have got a special offer for you. Yes, the first 3 months, half price with the code UP50. Type in UP50. You get the first 3 months of the ultimate service. And Gavin, you know it is the ultimate service.
Yeah, information is power, Dave.
Would you be lost without it?
I would.
We won't be able to find you
anywhere. That and a sat-nav.
UP50. Become a Racing Post ultimate member. First 3 months, half price.
Why not?
So it's time to find out what's happening this week. And it is Tinkle Creek Saturday. One of my favourite Saturdays of the year, Gavin. And in the Tinkle Creek, it is the return of Altior, who's now odds-on favourite after the 5-day forfeits. Where are you with Altior? You're ageist.
I am ageist.
The younger the better. Definitely. I know that sounds terrible. But when it comes to horses, the younger the better.
Yeah, definitely. But for him, because he's such an amazing horse, you have to probably make an exception. I think he'll win on Saturday.
Are you making an exception? Yeah.
He's 10 turn 11, but I think he'll beat...
Goes against all your rules, Gavin.
But you have to for him, sure. He's just a freak.
Yeah. Now, did you see Altior working alongside Epitant?
Yes. I thought Epitant worked the better of the two.
It'll probably remind me of me cycling against you in the charity cycle, because Epitant just travelled all over him. It was like she could have... But this is the thing that really gets me about Altior. Obviously, Altior is a fantastic horse, but I just thought in the last couple of years, it looks like he's got a little bit slower. I'm not saying he's got any worse, but it looks like he's got a little bit slower and he needs a little bit more...
Yeah, but there's been lots of times where he's looked beat in races. But he just wants to win.
But then you hear everybody from Henderson's, and I even spoke to Barry Geraghty before the Champion Chase last year, and he had done a bit of work at Nicky's, maybe sat on Epitone, and he said, do you want to see the piece of work Altior did?
Yeah.
So they say it's probably one of the fastest horses that's ever worked in their gallop, but in his races, he doesn't look fast.
No, he does hit flat spots here and there.
So that's the thing that baffles me about Altior. If he's this incredibly fast horse that pigeons can't catch in seven barrows, why is Epitone working all over him? Can you answer me that, Gavin?
She's very good.
Yeah, I don't know. I hope he wins. I do, because... And I think he's better than those, is he?
I think he's better than Grenadine. I think he's better than Politolog, yeah.
Yeah.
4-5. It was even money, I'd definitely have a bet.
The one horse...
I'd love to see him win.
...who is interesting is Rouge Vif. Obviously won a handicap at Cheltenham. Is getting better. And this race suits horses that were novice last season that are getting better.
The trainer says he wants good ground, and I believe there's a good bit of rain coming, so that could be a problem.
Okay, and that'll suit Altior. Obviously he was fine on... Yeah, any type of ground.
Yeah. He doesn't give you an excuse to get beat.
What price would Altior need to be for you to back him?
Ash, if he's even money or 10 to 11, I'll back him, yeah. Maybe okay. 4-5.
Okay.
But yeah, he should win. He's an amazing horse.
Yeah, and the vibes seem to be very strong.
Okay.
Even though I thought Epitone worked all over him.
Yeah.
There we go. That is the Tinkle Creek. Also on Saturday, it is the Henry VIII Novice Chase. The first Grade 1 Novice Chase in England.
Yeah, lots of good horses in it. All Mankind, Your Horse, Eldorado, Allen. Fusel Raffles, Galah, Phoenix Way, Tamarack de Mantan and Hitman. Really good race. I won't have a bet, but I can't wait to see. If something was really impressive, it'd be nice.
Yeah. Like, they're going to go like the clappers here.
Mm-hmm.
All Mankind just knows what to do. And he's going to be some sight over the railway fences.
Yeah, no. Sandown's an amazing race course. So yeah, that should be a good race to watch.
You know me, I'm very loyal. Is Eldorado Allen getting the credit he deserves for what he's done so far? He's been very good in two novice chases.
He has. We just don't know if he would have won in Cheltenham the last day. It's 50-50 because the horse in front fell at the second last, but...
Yeah.
You obviously thought he would.
I like him, yeah, I like him. Yeah.
He's, I think he's 9-2 or thereabouts.
Yeah, I thought that was a big price for Eldorado Allen. I think he's a good horse. And in Ireland on Sunday, we have the John Durkin, who could be Min, chasing a hat-trick of wins in the race. Likely to be against Battle Over Diane. We don't know if Allo is going to be in there because we obviously record this on Tuesday morning. But Min, still the most underrated horse in training?
Sure, he's great. It's just that he kept running into Altior for a few years.
Yeah.
But the John Durkin can be perfect for him. I see that Larichburg was in the long deck, so it'd be interesting if he ran Battle Over Diane, etc. But yeah, Min would be hard to beat. And also, the Many Clouds chase is on. Mm-hmm. Santini is running at the weekend, so it'll be good to see him out.
Are you a Santini fan?
Sort of, kind of, yeah. Yeah, obviously second of the Gold Cup, class act. He's against Native River, Frodon, Al Dancer, so he should beat them.
Okay, that's what's happening this week. Yes, folks, it's flown this week. We're on to our Ante-Post picks. Yes, myself and Gavin's latest selections for the 2021 Cheltenham Festival. Just the one this week. We're just being one. Selective,
yeah.
Gavin.
Yeah.
Do you want to go first?
Okay.
Go for it.
I'm going to go for a horse. I swore I wouldn't pick a horse in the Triumph Hurdle like February, but the performance on Sunday by Zana here.
You're not doing it. Was
are you incredible.
Picking Zana here?
I am, yeah. Get over it.
This is daylight robbery.
Four runs in the flat for Michael Halford, won a maiden. It won in Ballinrobe, first time over hurdles, beat a horse too disappointed since. One thing to note, that day in Ballinrobe was 2 miles, 2 furlongs, which is noteworthy that he had no problem staying.
Mm.
On Sunday, it was getting £4 from St. Sam and beat it 14 lengths, right? That's all fine. But when you go and analyse the time of the race, the time was 4.02. The time of the handicap hurdle was 4.08. The time of the bumper was 4.06 and the time of the Royal Bond was 4.12. The Royal Bond was slowly run, but let's compare it to the handicap hurdle at 4.08, all right? Same distance, same number of hurdles, etc., etc., etc. The first four home in the handicap hurdle carried 10-2, 11-10, 10-10 and 10-6. So there's lots of them carrying lightweights. He's only a three-year-old. He was carrying 10-11. To beat that handicap hurdle by 6 seconds, and Jack was easing him up in the last furlong, I thought it was a huge performance. So I wasn't going to pick a horse for the Triumph, but that was so good, I have to.
And did you feel in any way guilty picking Zanahir, given that I spoke about Zanahir on the show last week?
No.
Well, you picked. What are you going to do? Are you going to steal Eve on me next?
Well, you picked Elixir Danae ahead of me there last week, so that's fine.
Yeah, but that's...
Anyway, Zanahir at 7-1 I think is good value. I think he's got a massive chance. We're going to see lots of horses in the next month or two winning by 20 lengths and 10 lengths and three-year-old hurdles. And we'd say, oh, look at him, look at him. But he just already sets a high standard.
Okay, so just so viewers know, we make our selections on Monday morning. I'd say it was 9 o'clock. Gavin Lynch comes up on the phone. And I said, I bet you I know what this phone call's about. He's getting in there early. We send our selections through. Gavin, how's it going? I had my horse picked for Upping the Ante this week. I know what it is, Gavin. You do. It was Zana here. Yeah. stolen from my heart. Gavin Lynch has got Zana here. 7-1 with Bet365.
But you can still back it.
For the Triumph Hurdle. Because we picked Sarah de Berlay, the two of us, we want to have a little bit of a difference. So we're not going to go for the same horse this week. Gavin has got in there first. The early bird catches the worm. And in this case, he catches the Triumph Hurdle winner. 7-1. Zana here. Bet365. Triumph Hurdle. I think he'll win.
Gorgeous big horse. Jumps brilliantly. Travels great.
Love him. Love him.
There's no excuses.
Love everything about him. Love them at Ballon Robe. Love them even more at Fairy House. This is a racehorse. And I think 7-1. I could not believe they didn't go shorter. I could not believe it. I thought he'd be about 5 after the race.
Yeah, no, he looks very, very good.
There you go. Anyway, Gavin gets Zana here for the Triumph Hurdle. Okay, my selection this week would have been Zana here, but unfortunately, I'd have to look elsewhere, and I've gone to the Ballymore, and it is Brave Man's Game, who I know the time was slow, and it was a slowly run race at Newbury on Friday, but I think this is a horse that's getting better and better all the time. I wouldn't crab that form too much. I think Es Perfecto, who finished second, is a nice horse. Botwell Bridge was very impressive first time out at Warwick. I think he's a good horse, and he obliterated them.
Mm-hmm.
I like the way he jumped, I like the way he travelled. I think in a stronger run race, he's going to actually even be better. And I know we can't read too much into trainer interviews, but I did think it was very interesting that twice when Paul Nicholls was talking about this horse, he mentioned Denman. He's going to take the Denman route. He's going to take the Denman route. He's going for the Challow.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to see him over Christmas at Newbury. And I think if he wins that 16-1 is going to look a big price. Because I'm looking around the novices in England, and Nicky obviously is Allard. Not Allard. What's the name of the good horse?
Dusart.
Dusart. That won. And I'm just not seeing that many top novices in England come out yet. Obviously, there's going to be more. But I think he's going to go a favour for the Challow no matter what happens between now and then, okay? He was beaten by Soaring Glory first time out at Chepstow. So I thought it was immaturity that got him beaten. I think he's a different horse since. He came out and beat Runswick Bay at Exeter. Runswick Bay has won since. And as I said, I think the form of the race on Friday is better than people are given a credit for. And I think the fact that it was a slowly run race didn't pay to his advantage. I think 16-1 is value. And I think they really do like this horse.
If he wins the Challow, he'll be half that. So
That's my thinking. So 16-1, Brave Man's Game for the Ballymore is my latest pick for the 2021 Cheltenham Festival. Before we let you go, we're going to have a quick look at our Ante-Post portfolio so far. And Gavin, a lot of yours have shortened up. Sarah de Berlay, obviously sevens from
same
tens.
As you, yeah.
Tower Bridge in the Pretemps, there's been a lot of interest in that. And the double last week, you tipped up the double, Envoi Allen and Honeysuckle, 12.5-1. And what price is it now?
I think it's around 9-1. Just hopefully she goes to the Mayor's Hurdle.
I know, yeah. That's the big question, isn't it?
But Grant.
Are you happy so far?
Yeah, fine.
Yeah, you're happier than me anyway. So quick look at my list so far, and hopefully it's very quick. Mr. Fisher, Lord Royal, hopefully, Sarah de Berlay will do the business in the Stairs Hurdle 10-1. And Elixir Danae, I think we might see him this week over fences. I think he's entered up. So Elixir Danae for the Arkle, 33-1. And then,
if you're going for big priced ones, that's going to happen.
Yeah. I'm taking chances. Yep. You're playing it safe.
Correct.
Yeah. I'm going into the bus lanes trying to get into work quicker. You just leave earlier.
Yeah.
That's the way it works. So that's a look at our Ante-Post portfolio so far. So folks, that's it for episode 4 in the new series of Upping the Ante in association with Bet365. Have you enjoyed it, Gavin?
Yes, I'll go, Dave.
Plans for the week?
Actually, maybe me and you should go for a cycle, I think, just to get you going.
Well, I actually can't at the moment because I've no bike.
Ah, here.
Yeah, I'll have to ask Santi for a bike for Christmas.
Yeah. No, I'll give you some details next week on the cycle, so that should be good.
More details on the charity cycle that Gavin Lynch has organised in next week's show. We've got the Tinkle Creek, we've got the John Durkin.
Yeah, great weekend.
Plenty to look forward to. Don't forget to join us next week for episode 5 of Upping the Ante.